Hey, Viola.
Hey, Pam.
Oh, must
Bless
be all of these allergies in the air. Or maybe I have asthma. I don't know. If I see a patient who are on any of these medications or complain about allergies, what do I do for them?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
All right, I'm not going to win an Oscar for my fake sneeze. I know. But we have patients all the time, especially now, especially, the end of the pandemic seems to be in sight, that patients are kind of coming in with illnesses other than COVID, or they're just saying they're getting a lot of allergies. And all of a sudden, those who have had asthma, their symptoms are starting to kick up. And many patients tell us that they have medications, but I don't generally see it on their person. So, can you enlighten us a little bit about what we're going to do for these people to keep them healthy?
Absolutely. So remember, again, we have to be the detectives, the sleuths, okay? We take a medical history, and maybe the patient tells us they have asthma, or maybe they don't. But when we see the medications on their medical history, we know that they're used to treat certain conditions. But of course, the question is, which conditions? Albuterol, which a lot of people use for respiratory conditions, can be used for multiple things. It could be used for just seasonal allergies, where people get this sort of intermittent asthma, although it's not true asthma. It's just sort of this reaction to pollen in the air. They could use it for true asthma, where they get episodes of asthma throughout their life, or it could even be used for mild to moderate symptoms of COPD. So we don't know what the patient has. We just know they're using albuterol. Well, this time of year, with stuff floating around in the air as fall sets in, it could be any one of those things, or maybe all three, depending on how reactive the airway is. So we have to remember that albuterol has effects that impact dentistry. First and foremost, it causes xerostomia, and that's a problem, okay? Second is it causes tachycardia. And again, that's a problem because, again, we're measuring blood pressures and pulses. But keep in mind, the biggest problem is that inhalers, like albuterol inhaler, is so easy to use. Inhalers are so easy to use that a lot of people misuse them. They use them incorrectly. And I've seen people do this. They'll take the inhaler, they'll shake it, you stick it in their mouth, and they spray twice and put it in their pocket. And really, what that does is put the medication in their mouth. They have to be taught to use the inhaler like a snorkel so that they breathe through the device, depress the plunger, and then take the drug in and hold it in their lungs. So that way the drug ends up more in their lungs than in their mouth. But beyond albuterol, there's longer acting beta-2 agonists like Sarovent that are for chronic maintenance of asthma, but also COPD. And then there's steroids, even combination drugs like Advair. Asthma is an inflammatory condition. So is COPD. So the best way to treat it would be with an anti-inflammatory, but not necessarily used to treat allergies. So that's why it's the three questions we've always talked about, Pam. What do you take? Why do you take it? And did you take it today? You really have to know your patient, treat every patient like a family member, and don't treat a stranger, right? So you know their medical history, you know their medication and medical history, and you're able to make a decision and ask them questions.
Now, there's some people, especially for asthma, that take an inhaler or something like that, or a nebulizer on a regular routine basis. So you said know the med, know how much they're taking, and ask them if they take it today. If they don't usually take it today, and if they take it PRN, but they happen to have taken it today because they're having a flare-up, what considerations should we have for them?
Now, a lot of people pre-dose with their albuterol inhaler because the stress of a dental appointment can trigger an asthma episode as well. I mean, ask some people what's the most stressful place they can find themselves, and what are they going to tell you? Divorce court. No, they're going to tell you a dental chair. Okay, so if they're in your chair and they've pre-dosed, what does that mean? Well, they're going to be tachycardic. They're going to have a higher pulse. They're going to have xerostomia, and they're going to be jittery. And don't forget now, add all that up and say, oh, I guess I need to use epinephrine in this local anesthetic to make it more profound so that it won't be so much pain, so they won't be so stressed. But using epinephrine can increase their blood pressure and their heart rate. So it's really important to take blood pressure, heart, and heart rate, and know roughly how much albuterol they've used in advance so that you can use as the least effective amount of anesthetic with epinephrine or go no epi at all. Just keeping in mind that no epi isn't always a solution. Using, for example, mepivacaine without epi is wonderful because it doesn't have any epi, but it doesn't last very long. So we get breakthrough pain, you end up getting endogenous epinephrine. So all of that plays in to making the right decision for your patient. I would recommend that patients bring their inhaler with them, but not pre-dose. Very important also, keep the inhaler within their line of sight. Don't put it in a drawer. Don't put it, you know, tucked away somewhere where you know where it is, because just the visual, you know, seeing my inhaler close by gives me comfort and reassures me. If I don't see it, I'm going to get more anxious.
What about those that take allergy pills?
Oh, yes. Antihistamines, especially Benadryl this time of year, Claritin, Zyrtec, all very popular. Keep in mind that they come in two varieties, right? The sedating antihistamines like Benadryl and Dimetapp, which was my all-time favorite when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And then the non-sedating like Claritin and Zyrtec. But at the same time, antihistamines do cause a lot of drying. They can cause tachycardia. And I hate to say it, but there are some people who get so used to taking Benadryl, they end up taking it in large doses and can actually get hallucinogenic episodes. Some people do abuse Benadryl to get high. I don't recommend this. This is not a self-instruction video. I'm just saying it's possible that Benadryl can be overused because of that effect. So we want to make sure that patients are using Benadryl as recommended, which is, you know, no more than one or two capsules. Claritin and Zyrtec and Allegra are considered non-sedating, but they can also cause some fatigue. And so that could be interpreted as you know, some sleepiness. And watch out for the decongestants, you know, Claritin D, for example, or anything with the D in it, because the dextrin, the D, the decongestant, is typically Sudafed if you buy it by the pharmacist, or phenylephrine if you get it outside in the aisle. But both of those can raise blood pressure and pulse somewhat. And that goes the same for Afrin nasal spray, which a lot of people use as well. That can cause rebound congestion, and that can also raise blood pressure and pulse as well.
I think it's just a best practice to take your patient's pulse and blood pressure at the beginning of every appointment, especially if you're going to administer a local anesthetic as part of that appointment.
No question about it. And the main cause of here is that if you read that study from 2014, it still holds true. Many people see their dental professional more than they see their doctor. So if you're taking their blood pressure and pulse every time you see them twice a year, who's really taking their blood pressure and pulse on a regular basis? You are. Who's really, you know, supervising their diseases? You are, you know, more than their doctor.
We have such a unique opportunity to take really, really great care of people. And I think that's such an honor, but it's also such a responsibility. And I think we are doing it well, but we can certainly step up our game. And I think that you're helping us step up our game every single time we shoot these videos. So thank you.
Same I could say for you, Pam. You're raising the profession one medical history mystery at a time.
Yes, we are. So I guess we're out of time, but don't worry, we'll be back next week.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. For Medical History Mysteries, I'm Pam Maragliano-Muniz with Tom Viola, and we'll see you next week. Bye.